H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.
And then I'll give you an idea about what is SQL, and then I'll tell you how to practice and how to learn SQL. So that's the first thing we are going to do today. So just think of this. Let's give you an example. Let's say I give you a truck full of books, okay? And then I give you a room, let's say any room in your house, and I told you, like, okay, do one thing. Store these books in your room. So what you did is you just dump all the books from the truck into your room. Okay? So that means you have actually stored the books into your room. And it's safely stored because it's a room in your home. So the books will not be damaged. Now, all of a sudden, after maybe a week, I told you, like, do one thing. Give me a book of physics from such and such a writer. Now, you have a room full of books, and I just ask you to search a single book out of that room, like room full of books. So let's say that room has maybe 5,000 or 10,000 of books, and I just ask you to find one book. So the only way you can find that book is, what you have to do is you have to go to that room and start searching that specific book, and you have to go through each and every book. So if you are lucky, then what will happen, the first book you picked up, maybe the physics, the book of physics which I'm looking for. And if you are unlucky, then what you have to do is you have to go through each and every book and the last one is the one which I am looking for, right? So this is an idea like how I am storing the books. Now, to make my searching of books more efficient and storage also more efficient, right? Because maybe the room in which you have stored 5,000 books, since the storage is not efficient, what happened is there is no room for any further books. So, but if I can store the books in a more disciplined way, then what will help me is maybe I can adjust another 2,000 or 3,000 books in that room. Okay, so let's just think of a library, right? Now, so that is one example what I give. Now, let's think of this. I give you same thing, a truck full of books, and I give you the same room, but this time what you have done is you have stored the books maybe in a library pattern, okay? Maybe author-wise, subject-wise, something. So some pattern you have followed and you have stored the books. Now, when I told you, like, I want a book of physics by such and such writer, it's now very easy for you to search the book. So you know which aisle has or which shelf has the physics books. You straight away go there, did a search on the author, and then either you found it or you didn't found it. So, but it's very easy. It's very less time consuming. Okay. So database concept is very much similar to that, okay? What database is doing is, database is nothing but a place where you store the data. But it's not just dumping of data. It is an organized form of storing a data. So Oracle is such kind of database, right? Now, Similarly, you have a lot of other database in the market, right? Like Oracle, DB2, Teradata, maybe SQL Server. There are a lot. Like there are maybe 10, 15 types of database already in the market. Now try to understand this thing now. Maybe just think of this. It's a library in USA and a library in China, a library in France, a library in Italy, a library in anywhere in the world, more or less stores the books in a similar pattern, right? Hold on for me. Excuse me. So, library in anywhere in the world more or less stores the books in a similar pattern. So when I'm saying similar pattern, definitely the language is different, but you go to any of the libraries and you just tell them, okay, I'm looking for a book of physics, they can easily tell you, okay, go to this aisle or go to this room. Some, like, easily they can direct you to a specific location which has all the books of physics. So the what I'm trying to tell you is, even though these are all different libraries, but they follow some similar pattern of storing the data so that storing the books so that books can be searched very, very quickly. Now, this is true for database also. So when I'm there may be like 10 different or 15 different in database, but storing the data into the database and reading the data from the database, everyone uses a common structured language which is called SQL, SQL, okay? So everyone uses a common language. Now, what happens is SQLs are almost, I would say, 85% SQLs are similar in all databases. So if I write select star from employee, this SQL will return all the employee data from the employee table. And this SQL will run in any database. But 15% of the SQL language are different from the different databases. Okay? Any questions for me? No?
Mm-hmm.
Hey Bharti, you joined a little late, so I am giving introductory.
Yeah, sorry, I didn't get the information that I have the class for today at the morning.
Oh, is it? Okay, I thought they have sent it to everyone. Okay. So, okay, let me ask you this thing. Do you have a database knowledge or SQL knowledge?
Yeah, a little bit.
Okay, that's fine. So this is basically an introductory class for database and SQL and then introductory class for data warehouse and then basics of Informatica. Okay. Okay. So what I want you to do is, for the people who have already installed an SQL, what you have to do is you'll go in SQL class.
Okay.
SQL class, and then you'll exactly type this sys as sysdba, enter.
Okay.
For password, just enter, and then what you have to do is you have to unlock the Scott schema. So you will do this thing, alter user scott, sorry. SCOTT Scott account unlock.
Okay.
And then what you have to do is you will be doing alter user Scott identified by Tiger. Okay.
Okay.
Once you do this, then either you can practice in this SQL Plus, or what you can do is you can go here in Oracle Home, you will find this thing.
Okay.
Here in the username you will write Scott, and in the password you will write Tiger. And for the people who will be using SQL Plus, what happened? Let's see, what is Scott, T-I-G-E, Tiger. Let's put CSDB and try. The username or password is not valid. Scott, T-I-G-E-R. That's what I did, right? Oh, sorry, let's do this. Try again. Scott, T-I-G-E-R. Yeah, it's going here. So people who will use this black screen, they can use this one. So now here you can write your queries that I'll show you later, but why it's not used. The application requires more database privilege. Okay, let's do this. Hold on. As SysDBA grant DBA to Scott. Okay, let's now try this. DIGR. Yes, now it's working. So the difference, only difference between this black screen and this web-based application is this web-based application looks more tabular form. So the people who are just doing this is for the first time, for them it's more convenient to understand what is happening. So mm-hmm. You'll go here, you'll go in this SQL worksheet, and this is the place where you'll start writing your SQL queries. Now, I will share this document with everyone. If you go to the first chapter of this document, it has a lot of SQLs. Okay, this document will tell you basics about database, tables, what is table, what is row, what is column, and then and it has all the SQLs, like how to write the SQLs. And so see, the part one is queries. From here it starts the SQL. Okay. So for example, it says let's just select star from EMP. So if you just don't copy it from here, I'm copying it, but don't copy it, just write it here so that you will have some practice. Okay.
Okay.
Don't copy it. So select star from EMP. And if I run this, you'll see the results. So now you know that select star from EMP means, select star means give me everything from
employer details. Yeah.
Hey, Bhatti, would you mind to go on mute, because maybe other people feel disturbed, okay? Sorry for this. So EMP is one of my tables. So it says select star from EMP means give me everything which is there in my EMP table. So how do I know what are the tables present in this? It's Scott. So I'll do select star from tab. Okay. Select star from tab. When I execute this, it gives me the list of tables present. So I have right now, I have table called bonus table, called DEPTs table, called EMP table, called cell grid. Okay, so this document, whatever you see here, like whatever SQLs are here, all those SQLs can be executed in this user, Scott Tiger. So read the document and execute those SQLs, as you should be able to see the answer. That way you will learn so quick. So this document is not a big document, it's a very small document. This gives you a very quick and basic idea about your SQL. So any questions for me?
No, I think I have to do it.
Yeah. So what you have to do is do this. This is very important. So we don't need SQL immediately, but after we are done with halfway of the course, we definitely need SQL. So that's why you have at least 2 to 3 weeks of time right now to learn SQL parallel with the Informatica, basically. Okay.
So, okay, sure.
So this is more or less basics about SQL and database. Now let's start with our data warehouse stuffs. Okay. So how many of you have an idea about what is data warehouse, what is ETL and all? Hello. Bharti, do you have an idea about what is data warehouse?
I think the place where we store the historical data, and through the ETL we extract it for developing the reports.
Yes, high level, that's correct. Yes. Okay, Bharti, can you do one thing? Can you ping me your email address so that when I send these documents, I'll make sure that you are in the loop.
Okay, sure.
Yeah. Okay, so give you a detailed background about the data warehouse and why do we need data warehouse. Let me just explain this to you. So data warehouse comes under the business intelligence. So when we say business intelligence, we are talking about data warehouse, we are talking about reporting, so we are talking about ETL, okay, along with other things. So now, any business intelligence project these days are very expensive projects, okay? And these companies are spending so much money into business intelligence projects. So why is the reason? Let's understand this. So think of this. This is some of the example which I usually give to all my students. Just think of this. All of a sudden, let's say American Airlines decided that we want to make a profit, okay? Let's say it's the beginning of 2014 and American Airlines decided, okay, we couldn't make a good amount of profit in the last quarter of 2013, which is October, November, December. That quarter, we couldn't, October, November, December, that's correct, yes. We couldn't make a very good profit in that quarter, so we should plan from the beginning of 2014 so that we can make at least maybe, let's say, I'm just throwing a figure, so let's say we want to make a profit of maybe $10 million in only the last quarter of the year, or maybe $5 million only the last quarter of the year. So I'm talking about the profit. Now, what happens is it's a decision came from the top management, right? So they want, this is one of the goal for this year. We have to make a profit of $10 million in the last quarter of 2014. Now, there is an execution team who works with the top management, and they sit together and they decide, okay, now, if we have to make a $10 million profit, what we have to do is we have to see like what are the possibilities and what are the different ways we can do it. So one way is we cannot just start creating new VR planes and we start the service to the places where we don't have service at this point of time. That is not a very big, very good idea, because that requires a lot of investment, and putting so much money, I don't think we can make that big profit at the end of the year. So what we can do is we have to, because the time, the overall timeline is very short. It's like we have 9 months to find a solution, and then we have to execute in the last 3 months of the year to get that profit. So another way is what we can do is if we can intelligently increase the number of flights between different airports, so that we can make more profit. So that is a good idea. We can increase the number of flights between different airports. But how do I know? Like, where do people go in last quarter of the year? So let's think of this. Does people go in New York last quarter of the year? Maybe yes, maybe no. And if people go in New York, what are the different places from where people come to New York? And does people fly from New Jersey to New York? I don't think so. People will drive or take another kind of commute. Does people come from Florida to New York? I don't think so. People will like to be in Florida in in the winters, right? So I have to find out, like, which are the other areas, other places from where people fly to New York, okay? And then other destinations are like, does people go to California? Yes. Does people go to Florida? Yes. Does people go to San Francisco? Yes. So these are the places, like, let's say I have, like, maybe 15 places where people usually go in the winter, like last quarter of the year. Then I have to find out, like, I understand that people are coming to these places, but I have to also know which are the places from which people are, from where people are coming, because unless I know those places, I cannot increase the flight between two airports, right? So the next thing is I have to find, like, okay, what are the different places from where people are flying to these destinations? So once I know these two, then I have to know that, okay, I have to find a optimal number of flights, so that let's say I just randomly increase the number of flights, and what happened is I am flying maybe two airplanes with maybe 10% or 15% of the passengers, which doesn't make sense to me. So I have to intelligently increase the number of flights so that each flight is almost full. So the whole idea, like, why I'm trying to tell you this story is, how do I take all these decisions? Whatever I have told you, how do I take all these decisions? The only way to take these decisions is I have to go back and look to my historical data to find the pattern of the how people have behaved in the last 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, or 10 years. Unless I know that pattern, it's not possible for me to understand whether people, like, which are the places people fly. Because let's think of this, maybe in early 2000 and maybe mid 2000, people used to fly in New York, used to go in Florida, but now people found that, okay, no, New York is very crowded at that point of time, so we don't want to go there, rather let's go to Colorado and have some ski sports. So now people are going more to Colorado than Florida or New York. So how do I know this? So when I look to the historical data, I will see that, okay, people used to go in New York and Florida, but the pattern has already changed. Now for the last 3 or 4 years, we see the people are going to Colorado. So let's do something like, let's increase the number of flights to Colorado and give some good deals, get some good optimal calculations for what should be the number of flights, and then let's work on it. So to take this kind of decision, I need that historical data, and not maybe not for the last 20 years, but definitely for last 10 years data, so that I can understand the pattern. Or if I don't have last 10 years data, maybe at least last 5 years data to understand the pattern. So now, so this is the whole idea, right? So how do I, so the place where I will be storing the last 10 years data and last 5 years data, that place is called a data warehouse, where I'll be storing that data. The execution team will come up with a requirement saying that I want to see the different sources, like how many people have flew in last quarter of each year from different sources to different destinations. So that is a kind of requirement for a reporting. That reporting requirement will come to the data warehouse guys. They will process the data, and the reporting guys will just read the data from your data mart or data warehouse to report them. And based on that report, they will take a decision. Now, one thing you have to understand is, since we are talking about the data, for the last 5 years data. Now, definitely the data for the last 5 years are not stored in the same way. That means, maybe first 2 years data was stored in data was captured in Oracle system, but later on they changed the system and now the data is captured in a SAP. So when I'm generating a report for the last 5 years, I have to read the data from SAP as well as from Oracle. So ETL is the guy who will read the data from Oracle, read the data from SAP, and store the data into data warehouse. Okay. So Informatica is one of those ETL tools who is capable of reading data from any place and storing it to a data warehouse. So any questions for me about the concept of data warehouse? Any questions? No. I will be sending this document, like few of you already have this document. So now, since I already told you the basics about the data warehouse, I would suggest you to go through this document for the first 2 pages. At least first 3 pages, sorry, first 3 pages, okay. Okay, I'll send this document to Vati, okay? Now, let's go to your Informatica. So people who already have installed Informatica, let's start with this, hold on. Now, just think of this. Think of this. Let's say there is a source system who has who is generating a file and sending it to you, and then what you have to do is you will have to read that file and load it into generating another file. So this is called a CSV file, comma separated file. Okay, where you will see the first column is your column name, which is says employee ID, first name, last name, email, phone number, hired date, job ID, salary, commissions, manager, department ID. And then these are all data, and each data is separated by a comma. That means this is your employee ID, this is your first name, this is your last name, okay, this is your email. So these are called CSV, comma separated file. Let me just show you how to open this window. So just think of this. So you are getting this comma separated file, and what you have to do is you will be reading this file as a source and then generating another file. Okay. So to open Informatica, what you have to do is you'll go here. You will see something called Informatica, then client, then Power Center client, and then go to Power Center designer. You have to give your user ID password. Okay. So these things, you will not see all these things so everything will be blank. So even you will not see any other sources. So what you have to do is, this is your Power Center Designer, and this is a place where we create the blueprint of our logic. So that means now the requirement I have given is you have to read this read this source file and generate another file with some requirement changes, like I want to maybe concatenate the first name, last name, and I want to do some changes in the phone number. Okay. So these are the basic requirements, and then I want you to generate another flat file. So this is called your source analyzer, where you will import the source structure. So try to understand this. In Informatica Designer, I am not doing anything with the data. What I am doing is I am trying to import the source structure, and I am trying to create the target structure, right? I am not dealing with data. So what I am doing, what I'll do is I'll go to source, I'll do an import from file, because I have got that file structure. So I'll do an import from file, I'll be sending these files to all of you. Source files, and then let's say I have this employees file. Okay. Now I will do import field name from the first line, because my first line is my column names, right? So I'll do this, do next, and then my file is a delimited file, right? It is delimited by comma. So if I go next, you see these are the delimiters you can use. You can use tab, semicolon, space, or you can use other, and in other you can use your own delimiter. But for this file, the delimiter is a comma. So I'll use comma and do next. Now when I do next, let's do finish. Okay, now I'll rename it as employees _, let's say test. Okay. So when you do this, you will see that Informatica has automatically determined the data type of all the columns. How? What Informatica did is he will look to the data and he will just try to determine the data type. So if you look to the first column, the data is all numeric, right? 101. So that's why what he has done is he made it number 3. Maybe this is correct, maybe this is not correct. Because if you look to the first name, Informatica has given the length as 11, right? We'll come to this later. So Informatica has given the length as 11. how he has given the length as 11. He has read the data like what for the maybe first 10, 15 records, and he found that, okay, 11 is the max character of the first name, so he has given 11. But in real requirement, maybe the requirement is my first name should be at least 30 characters long, and this is something which will be given to you. It's not like you have to determine. Someone will give you that, okay, you use 30 characters as a first name, 30 characters as a last name, okay, and then use employee number as a string 3, something like that, okay. So what I'm doing is right now I'm just making few columns as string because I will be dealing with those columns, okay. So I just made control S. Now, so this is my source structure, okay. This has nothing to do with data. This is my source structure. That means it tells, this source structure tells me that I have some file which has all this column data, and then this file is nothing but a comma separated value file, okay. Now let's create the target. Now for target, since I don't have the target file with me, I cannot just go here and do like import from a file. What I have to do is I have to create it. So I'm creating employee_test, and the database type is file. Done. Okay. Now let's do it fixed width to see how the fixed width file looks like. So instead of doing it comma delimited, I made it fixed width, and now I will add the columns. So my first column name will be emp_id, and I'll make it string 3. The next column name is, let's say, full name. I'll make it string 60. And next column name is, let's say, phone number. And I'll make it as string maybe 15. Okay. And then let's add one more, let's say department. Number. String 10. Okay. Click OK. So and this is my source analyzer where I design my source structure. This is my target designer where I design my target structure. Now comes my mapping designer where I will do the mapping of source to target. Okay. Mapping of my source to target. So what I'll do is I'll create mapping, create and give some name. Let's say m_employee_test. Okay. And so this is now the place where I have to do the mapping. So I have to build my logic here. So to build the logic, I have to bring my source. Where is my source? Once you create the source, you'll see that your source, like when you will first time log in, you'll see all your folders are empty. Once you create the source, you'll go here and you'll be able to see your source. So my source is employees_test. You drag and drop it here, you will see the source, and there will be another transformation which is source qualifier. At this point, just know that whenever you bring the source qualifier comes by default. We will go in details of source qualifier, but not now, later on. So this is my source qualifier transformation, and then I will go to my target, and this is my target. Okay. Now I can see I have these columns coming in from source, and these are columns I have to connect into my target. So there are intermediate some transformations which are called, like we will be learning a lot of transformations, but this is right now we are looking to the expression transformation. Okay. In the expression transformation, what I'm doing is I'll bring the employee ID, I'll bring the first name, last name, as I have to create the full name. I'll bring the phone number, and I'll bring the department number. Okay. Then first name, full name is nothing but a concatenation of first name and last name. So if you look here, each port has like three characteristics. It says IOV. I is for input, O is output, and V is for variable. We'll learn V later on, but at this point, I and O. Now, I and O means if, see, all these ports are I and O, that means you will see input, and also they are ready to be connected to the next transformation. They are eligible for output. So what I'm going to do is, my, since I don't need first name and last name as output, I will remove the output. Now look here, you don't see that, you cannot connect them to the next port because they are only input. And what I'm going to do is I will create one more port here which is called full name. And make it as string 60. And make these ports as first name, concatenate, let's put a space, and last name. Okay? Now, if I connect this one to full name, I'll connect the employee ID to my employee ID. Now, phone number, I want to do some changes in my phone number. Let's say if I go to the employees, this one, I see the phone number is in this format. I want to change the format. I want to make the format something like this. So, I want to change the format like this, 515124 4567. Okay, so this is your, these are all your requirements, that's what you are doing. So phone number also I'll make it as an input port because this is not required as my output. I'll create another port called out underscore phone, let's put in caps, phone underscore number. I think it's string 15, let's put 15. Make it output port. Now this is very important. To change that specific format, we have a lot of functions here. We have to use them. So what I'm going to do is I'll just use this function and let me know if you don't understand it. Okay. So my, I have to add first a bracket and then I have to read the first three characters. So to read the first three characters, I have a function called, so I'll go to character, I'll see what are the functions available. I see there is a function called substr, so which reads nothing but the substring. So I'll read the substring of phone number from first place until three places. Okay? And once that is done, and I will concatenate this part, right? So I will concatenate this thing with next three characters. So next three character comes from 1, 2, 3, 4, fifth location, three characters. So I'll read phone number from fifth location, read three characters, and then after that again concatenate this one, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9th location, four characters, right? So I'll go here, read 9th location. Four characters. Okay. So that's how my phone number looks like, and then this is my department. Okay, department is showing up as a decimal, right? Number. Let's change the department also to. Or we can keep it number. Let's keep it number. So now this is your mapping. This gives you the idea about what, how the logic is implemented to achieve your requirement. Now once your mapping is done, you have to create your workflow. So that's very easy. You go here, right click the mapping, and do a generate workflow. Okay. Now this green one is designer, where you work first, and once that is done, you move to the workflow manager, that red one. You click on this workflows, you will see the one you generated will be there. So the one we generated is employee_test. Now here, in this is called a station. Now in this station, so this complete thing is called your workflow. This arrow and this station together call your workflow. And this is called your station. Now in the station, what you are doing is you will tell Informatica that where exactly is the location of your file. So for you, for me, my location of the file is this one, C source files, okay? So this is my location of the file. I'll say the source file directory is this one. And then, what is my file name? My file name is, my file name is, let's say, employee_new is my file name, okay? So employee_new is my file name. So let's say I'm doing employees_new.txt. And where I want to see my target, output file, I have another folder which is called TGT files. These are the folders I created. You can create your own folder where you want to see the files. So you go here, output file directory, you go here and you give the target and you give that file name you want to see. So let's put it employee_test.txt. And in no headers, I'll put as output field names. And let's save this. Now I have to run this one. So you first go to your workflow monitor, which is this M. Okay, once you go connected, then right click here and do start workflow. And then you will be able to see that your workflow is running here. So now double click this session, you will see how many records read and how many records went to the target. See, it says 107 record reads, and this is your target. 107 records went to your target. Now I want to go to my, this is my file created. So I want to go to the employees test file and see how it looks like. So this is my fixed width file. So fixed width file means it, this width is, so I have assigned 60 characters for our full name, so it will take 60 characters here. Okay. Similarly, I have whatever I have taken here, it will take that much of. So, but you got the first name and last name concatenated. You the phone number format is changed. Right. So, now any questions for me? Anyone? Any question? Yeah, please. Hello, go ahead.
No questions.
Do you have a question? I couldn't get you. Like, yes, no. Okay. So now what I want you people to do is, these are the basics of Informatica, okay? Now what I want you to do is, I'll be sending out this file and all the documents to Bharti and also to you. Now what I want you to do is, if your installation is already done, right, then you do whatever I have done now, you do.
H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.